come before you in the name of Jesus. We thank you for this privilege to come together in this place and have the freedom to be able to worship and to teach your word and to meet with you. Thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us. Thank you again for the rain that you sent to our valley. Lord, we need a lot of water. We need a lot of rain. And so I thank you for it every time you
send. Thank you so much for your faith. We thank you for the work that you've done in his heart and showing him his great need for you. And Lord, thank you for doing that in so many hearts present with us this morning. So we rejoice that you brought yet another one into your kingdom. And God, we just thank you so much for the work that you've done and the work that you're going to do in his life and making him a witness of your grace and your compassion and your power. And so, Father, as a church, we just commit to bringing him into this fold, into this family, and encouraging him, Lord, praying for him, and taking part of the fruit that you'll bear from his life. We thank you so much. And
says, after these things, the Lord appointed 70 others, or some say 72, and others also, and sent them two by two before his face into every city and place where he himself was about to go. So you see, he's sending out messengers to warn people he's coming. Then he said to them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. If you weren't prepared to be a witness, but you're born again and you have the indwelling person of the Holy Spirit, you will at least be stirred up to know this is a person God chose who's calling and asking you to explain it, and God will show you how to explain what you're able, and he will at least motivate you to get up and find somebody else to help answer the rest of the questions. Do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He's the one that supplies all my needs according to his riches and glory. So when they came back rejoicing and he heard them say, even the demons are subject to us in your name. Pride was a great danger. That's why he said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Do you know why Satan fell from heaven? Why did Satan fall from heaven? One word. Pride. Pride. He wanted to be God. It's pride. That's the great danger, pride. So if you want to fall, start thinking you're all that. Or whatever. That was the warning there. Anyway, that's why he also said the next verse, behold, I give you the authority. So his first, he says, Satan fell from heaven. Why? Pride. Behold, I give you the authority. In other words, remember who you come from. Remember who you are. Remember who you belong to. Remember who by his grace made salvation possible for you. He was given him that warning. And that's why he saw Satan fall, because of pride. Fourth thing, rejoice if you have spiritual sight. If you're able to see some spiritual things, rejoice in that, in your being able to see things, because the only way you're able to see and understand spiritual things is by the indwelling Holy Spirit. You can't see things and understand things just because you're smart. There's a lot of smart people in the world, and they're smart and lost. They're so smart, they think they know more than God. They think there is no God. They think they don't need God. And I want to tell you that I don't care how big a brain you got, if you don't have humility and faith in God, you're foolish. You may be smart, but you may be very foolish and actually ignorant of the greatest truth. There is only one Savior, one Lord, one God. So when Jesus rejoiced, he said, I thank you, Father, that you've hidden these things from the wise and the prudent. That's who he's talking about. People who think they're all that. People who think they don't need God because I have accomplished so much in my life. I'm smart, too smart. I don't need any help. I don't need anybody teaching me. I am too busy for that. And I want to say, he says, you've hidden these things from the wise and prudent. That's why it doesn't matter what you do, as long as a person is arrogant and prideful, they cannot see spiritual truth. It could be standing right in front of them. They can't see it. They can't hear it. They can't understand it because they won't accept it. Why would Jesus reveal himself to somebody who doesn't believe in him and doesn't accept him? He's not going to. He says, if you don't want me, okay, you are on your own. I wouldn't want to be in that position. I want to be the guy who says, okay, I'm looking and seeking. I want to know the truth. God, reveal the truth to me. If you're really there, reveal the truth to me. And then he says, oh, you want to know? And he opens your, it's like, boing, the windows come open. The ears can hear. And you begin to understand what you've always been looking for. Says he turned to his disciples and said, blessed are the eyes which can see the things you see. Be thankful to God that God has opened your eyes to see and your ears to hear. Look at verse 24. He says, I tell you, the prophets and kings desire to see what you see and haven't seen it. Do you realize if you're a Christian that you're able to see and understand things that other people don't even think are there? They don't even think it's there. They can't believe it. It's just explained it. It just explained it. That's why some cannot see it, don't think there's any need of it, don't want to know anything about it, because they've rejected the one who is the truth. And if they reject him and they reject his word, they can't see it, they can't understand it, they don't think it's there. It's like self-deceived. And I didn't see any of this and couldn't understand it until I came by faith. I got on my knees and I asked God to forgive me. And I told him I'd been wanting to know him. And that I believed his son Jesus had died for me. Would he please forgive me of my sin? And I want to tell you, I got down so broken. And when I stood up, I felt like the whole world had been lifted off my shoulders. I was set free. I had a whole new life. I was being transformed into a completely new person. It wasn't me. No self-help course. Then maybe somebody says, yeah, but you don't understand. I've done this and this and this. I don't see how God could love me. He loves you. I promise. You can say, but I don't see how in the world I've done these things, and I don't see how in the world God could forgive me. He is willing. He said, whoever comes to him, he won't push you out. He will accept you. You could say, there's a lot of things, maybe I didn't do all these things, but there's a lot of things I didn't do that I was supposed to do. I should have done some things. I don't see how God could forgive me. He will forgive you if you just come to him and say, would you please forgive me? I am sorry, forgive me. And he'll forgive you. I cannot begin to tell you what a change it makes when you are able to lay all these burdens at his feet and he forgives you and accepts you and you know you're loved and he's come into your life and now you're his, and all the things you couldn't see and understand before, it's like the understanding opens up. You're able to see and understand all these things. I'm just saying to you, trust him. You have a friend, I don't care what they have done. I don't care what they haven't done. Jesus loves them. You can tell them to come, and Jesus will accept them if they just come to him and say, Jesus, I am a mess. I'm really messed up, and I don't know what to do with my life. Will you accept me? He will. Okay? So whoever you know out there, it doesn't matter what they've done or didn't do. Jesus loves them. In fact, if they are chosen, they'll have this conviction. They'll want to come. You know what else makes Jesus rejoice? When we trust him and we obey him.